No. Lights on. Okay, now it seems to be working, yes?
Yeah.
Okay. So, as people settle in. So today's talk is going to be about Gauss-Monning connections, but I thought since the discussion at the very end of last time was a little bit rushed about how you use rigid cohomology to compute zeta functions, and there were a number of questions and some follow-up questions afterward, I thought I would borrow 5 minutes for myself to just give a sort of high-level description of how you use what I did yesterday to actually compute a zeta function. And I think one of the projects my group was working on was to actually do this in an example. So this will help explain what it is that that they did last night. So the paradigm for computing a zeta function, using Monsky-Washington, using rigid cohomology. So the paradigm is, so you start out with a situation where you have a comparison with Durham cohomology. So you start out with some situation where you have something like some Durham cohomology, you have some x over something like zq, and this thing, the Durham cohomology of the generic fiber is the same thing as the Monsky-Washington cohomology, or the rigid cohomology, more generally, of the special fiber. Although this is usually affine, so it is the Monsky-Washington cohomology. So usually my x is going to be, right, take some smooth thing, take some relative normal crossings divisor out, so like take a curve and take out some points that reduce to different places, mod p. And so you get a comparison map. So this thing, so you figure out how to compute in this thing. That's sort of component one, meaning you have to be able to, what does this mean? You have to be able to write a basis, and you have to be able to put elements into that basis, put elements in standard form. Meaning if, because elements are just represented by cocycles. They're represented by I-forms, which have derivative zero, and you have to be able to write them in terms of the basis element. So you have to be able to tell me an exact differential that I can subtract off to put this thing in terms of the basis element. So for the elliptic curve minus 1 point, I showed you how to do this. Well, minus 1 point, I showed you how to do this in lecture one. And I briefly sketched how to do this, or sort of hand-waved how to do this for the elliptic curve minus the two torsion points. That's explained a little bit more in the notes. But so you need to do this. And this is purely an algebraic thing. There's nothing p-adic about this part. And then over here, what happens is there's a Frobenius action over here. And you're trying to write down how that acts on some basis. So if you like, you can make a matrix that keeps track of Frobenius of basis element 1 is this combination of basis elements. And so, of course, the Frobenius is represented by, this is represented by some power series, because this is really a p-adic object. This Frobenius is not an algebraic object. So this Frobenius is represented by some power series, so you can take an element of your basis and apply Frobenius to it, but you get some infinite series. And so what you do is you truncate the action of f, or maybe I should call it f dagger, because that's what I had last time. So you truncate the action of Frobenius, which turns your form into some infinite series. You sort of truncate it by, say, ignoring things that are very divisible by p, and you get some large form. And now it's important that you can do this. You take that truncated thing and put it in your standard form. And that gives you an approximation of the true matrix of Frobenius up to some p-adic accuracy. And then you remember that, oh, well, what I'm trying to compute is a zeta function. It's a rational, I'm trying to rationalize some power series which has coefficients which are integers, and those integers can only be so big because there can only be, say, so many points over some field of on a curve of some genus. Or you use the Riemann hypothesis to say that the numerator of the zeta function has eigenvalues which have psi square root of q, if you're talking about a curve. So you use some Archimedean information on the size of the coefficients together with some p-adic restriction on the coefficients that comes from computing a truncated action of Frobenius. And if you do it right, you get enough information to uniquely determine all the coefficients. So that's the paradigm. As I said, part of my project group worked out an example of this, and I'm hoping this is one of the things they'll present, but that will be determined in consultation later. Are there any questions about anything from yesterday's lecture or this paradigm before I push ahead? Or did I get all the questions yesterday? Maybe I got them all yesterday. All right. Moving along. Okay, that did take about 5 minutes. Good. So the goal of today's lecture is to explain an alternate technique for computing zeta functions. But in fact, again, this is mostly geometry that doesn't have a lot to do with the p-adics. So I'll be doing a lot of geometry that makes sense complex analytically or rigid analytically or in the context of algebraic derived cohomology. And then at the end, I'll specialize to the rigid cohomology situation and tell you how you actually use this. So the motivating ideas here come from differential geometry. And in order to sort of encompass things, I'm going to talk about a quote space, unquote, without telling you what I mean exactly. I'll at least give you some options, though. So when I talk about spaces for the next few slides, here's what I could possibly mean. What is a space? I could mean a C infinity manifold over the real numbers, a complex analytic manifold over C. These are sort of the traditional examples. I could mean an algebraic variety over field K of characteristic 0, or I could mean a rigid variety. I probably want smooth. Did I say smooth? I probably want these things to be smooth. Smooth rigid variety, rigid analytic space, say, rigid space, over a rigid non-Archimedean field K, again, of characteristic 0. Some of what I've said, what I'll say doesn't require characteristic 0, but at the essential points, I'll want characteristic 0. So, yeah, you should imagine a C infinity example to start with, because that's where this notion comes from. So a connection is, well, here's the formal definition. Let me say what it really means. A connection, so you have a vector bundle on your space. So that means you have some family of vector spaces of some locally constant dimension on your space. And the total thing is itself a space of the same sort. So you have a map from this vector bundle down to your X, and the fibers are vector spaces of some fixed dimension. So in particular, you have a zero section, and you know how to add sections, and you know how to scalar multiply sections by functions on the base space. A connection is a map of bundles from V to, so you have this omega 1, the module of differentials, which I'll assume you know what it is in any of the categories I'm talking about. So you have it's a specification of how to differentiate. So you put in sections of your bundle and you get back sections of your bundle tensor 1 forms. It should satisfy the Leibniz rule, meaning if you have some open on which you're writing down sections, so F is a section of the structure sheaf, this should be O sub U, I suppose. And S is a section of your vector bundle. So if you have, so F you should think of as a scalar, and S you should think of as a vector. So when you differentiate the scalar times the vector, you can pull out the scalar and differentiate the vector, but then you also have to differentiate the scalar. And differentiating the scalar gives you a one form. There's, of course, a trivial example, which I didn't write on the slide, but I'll write it here. So the trivial connection is if V is the, I guess I'm not really distinguishing between vector bundles and their corresponding sheaves. So the vector bundle corresponding to the the trivial vector bundle, the trivial line bundle corresponding to the structure sheaf, has a connection which is just the exterior derivative. You just take exterior derivative, and that is a connection, not a very interesting one, but it's one nonetheless. So when one talks about these things, it's common to use somewhat evocative geometric language. One typically calls a section horizontal if its connection is zero. So somehow the connection is telling you how to move between fibers in a manner parallel to the base. Right? That isn't well defined without any extra information. The connection is sort of telling you if you have some, you have your base and you have some fibers above it, so you have some point on here, well, how do I move to a nearby fiber in such a way that I'm sort of staying parallel to the base? Well, what you're supposed to do is follow the image of a horizontal section. And if you sort of follow the image of a horizontal section, you imagine you're going parallel to the base. Now, of course, you could go in different directions. You could go, you know, if the base is the floor, I could sort of go this way and then this way, following along on my vector bundle. Or I could sort of go this way first and then this way, and I might sort of get to different places. And the reason is because there might be a curvature. This is sort of related to curved spaces and Riemannian metrics and so on, but I'm just going to talk about what I can say algebraically, which is I can talk about the curvature of a connection. So if you have a connection, so it maps from V to V tensor 1 forms, you also have, just like the exterior derivative from 0 forms to 1 forms induces an exterior derivative from I forms to I plus 1 forms, any connection induces maps that do higher differentiation. I'm just going to use the one that goes from V tensor 1 forms to V tensor 2 forms, and you just define it the way you are forced to continue to satisfy the Leibniz rule. So you differentiate both things that you see, and then you wedge things together to get into omega 2. And the curvature is the composite between nabla and nabla 1, which takes you from V to V tensor 2 form. And if this vanishes, we say nabla is an integrable connection. Well, we say that as algebraic geometers. Differential geometers would often call this a flat connection, but you can't use the word flat for this in algebraic geometry because it means something else, so you don't. Notice if x is one-dimensional, which is a case I'm actually going to be interested in a lot, then there's no bundle here. This is zero, so there's no restriction imposed by integrability. So this integrability really only matters if you have something which is more than one-dimensional. You'll see another interpretation of that in a moment. So curvature, the curvature being zero roughly means if I do this process I did before, if I sort of go this way and go this way, and I sort of follow along on along a horizontal section, and then I do it the other way, then I get to the same point, at least if I do this in a small neighborhood. So you can interpret this in terms of having an action of the fundamental group on your fibers. I might mention that again in lecture 4, but I won't need it right now. Okay. So action of a derivation. So if I have some local coordinates on my base space, then I get so the derivatives of these things, the differentials of these things form a basis of cotangent vectors, and so I get a dual basis of tangent vectors, which one normally writes as partial derivatives with respect to x1 through xn. And so you can contract a connection with one of these vector fields to get an action of this derivation on your bundle satisfying the Leibniz rule, meaning what happens is you get a map on, say, if you have sections of your vector bundle over some open, you get out sections of V tensor omega 1. You don't get the omega 1 because you're contracting with your tangent vector. You just get a section back. And this map satisfies the Leibniz rule, well, I'm writing it as an action of, say, del del xi, which means that I'm going to use the same letter for the action on functions and the action on sections, and you just get the Leibniz rule, which is that you if you want to differentiate a scalar times a vector, you differentiate the scalar, and then you differentiate the vector. So that's what I mean by an action of this derivation on here. It still satisfies the Leibniz rule. And integrability has a nice interpretation. It just means that these partial derivatives commute. So it means that you still, you know, what you learned in, or what you taught maybe more recently in multivariable calculus is still true. And this thing I was doing, this pantomime I was doing on the floor is in fact pantomiming the proof that mixed partial derivatives commute. And so you could try that with your multivariable calculus class. So as I said, I'm mostly going to be thinking about the case where the base is one-dimensional, so this doesn't really arise. This doesn't really arise, but this interpretation in terms of the action of a derivation is a good thing to think about. In particular, if your base is actually a subset of the affine line with some parameter t, you can imagine this connection is giving you an action of derivation with respect to t, and you can write it as a system of non-constant first-order linear differential equations, otherwise known as a system of first-order linear differential equations, meaning you take a basis of sections on some open, and you know you're differentiating, and this is described a little bit more in the notes that I tend to be somewhat more inclined to a geometric point of view, so I tend to think of an actual module with a connection, but if you prefer to think of a system of first-order linear differential equations, one can think of everything and write everything in terms of that language. And in fact, when you do calculations, you typically convert over into that form. Okay. So. The relative Durham complex. So maybe before I mention this relative Durham complex, maybe I'll say one more thing about connections. So why are interval connections interesting? Here's one thing that makes them quite interesting. That remember we had this Durham complex. Of you know where the maps are exterior, the maps are the exterior differentiation. You might think, well, if I have a vector bundle, I'd like to make a corresponding Durham complex where these maps are nabla, and this is nabla 1, and so on. And notice, the fact that this is a complex is equivalent to the connection being integrable. Well, I only told you that this composition is 0, but it easily follows that the other compositions are 0. So this is a complex if and only if nabla is integrable. So being the connection being integrable means you actually have a Durham cohomology theory associated to this vector bundle and its connection. So this leads to things like Durham cohomology with coefficients. And in the p-adic setting, it leads you to rigid cohomology with coefficients. And so this is very important for working with the theory, having these coefficients, but I wasn't going to talk about them, so I just leave that as a remark. Okay. But that shows you why integrability is kind of a nice condition. It has a cohomological significance. Okay, so the plan right now is that So here's a new situation that I haven't introduced yet. So maybe I should write it like this. So I have two spaces, again, spaces in finger quotes, X and S, and I have a smooth, now separated, since Brian insists. Of course, a lot of times this will be proper, and then whatever. But so I have a nice morphism of spaces, and I want to look at the relative differentials. So that, what that is you take say the absolute differentials on your space, and then you mod out by things that are pulled up from the base. So differentiating functions on the base should not have any should be zero. So these are the relative differentials. And if this morphism is smooth, then this is again a locally free sheaf on X whose dimension is equal, whose rank is equal to the relative dimension of the morphism. And again, I'm going to take the exterior powers of this over OX, and these form a complex. So maybe the one thing to not get confused about is that even though I'm doing this, I'm relativizing with respect to S, I'm still working with sheaves on the space upstairs. So these are still forms on the total space. Okay. So the relative Durham cohomology is then just you take the Durham complex made out of these things. So again, you have differentiation, and again it composes with itself to zero, so you have a complex, and you take the higher direct image of this pushing forward this complex. And so really, you should think of taking this complex in the derived category in X, taking the derived push forward down to S, and then taking the cohomology of the result. Of course, if you want to actually work with these things in practice, you might make some additional restrictions. So I want to be in the nice situation where so I say I have a proper morphism, and I guess my base is I'm always assuming my base is smooth. Then you get locally free sheaves, coherent sheaves, on S. I need to write this down. So this is important. I don't know why I didn't write it on the slide. So you have this relative Durham cohomology. So this is some sort of sheaf on S. And now what I claim is that if you stick a point, say little s, into S, because this is a proper smooth morphism, this formation of relative Durham cohomology commutes with whatever base change you want. So in particular, the fiber of this thing, the fiber of this sheaf at S is somehow canonically the Durham cohomology of the fiber of the morphism pi. So this sheaf really is it's a vector bundle, if you like, and the fibers really are the Durham cohomologies of the spaces, which are the fibers of the morphism. Yeah, Brian. I think so, but I don't know of reference off the top of my head. I'm only going to use it in situations that come from algebra, but maybe I better assume the morphism is projective or something, and presumably that isn't necessary, but maybe just to actually find it written down somewhere, you might need to assume it's projective. But in any case, yeah, the case I'm really interested in is the algebraic setting where this is okay. And I'm mostly going to be thinking about the case where the base is something affine, in which case you don't have to worry about the fact that this is a sheaf. You can just write down cohomology using the same sort of check complex that you use over a point. Now, what I really want is I really want to compute with families, say, of affine curves, because I know how to compute cohomology easily on, say, a single affine curve. So I really want to put an affine morphism here rather than a proper morphism. So instead, what I'm going to do is the usual thing of doing a logarithmic thing. So I'm going to take X to be proper, smooth and proper, and Z to be a relative normal crossings divisor. And then I can form relative Durham cohomology of this pair, which essentially X, the log scheme of X with the log structure determined by Z. And again, you get something coherent locally free. And it agrees with the relative Durham cohomology of the complement. It always agrees with the relative Durham cohomology of the complement, but in particular, I'm interested in the case where U is affine. So when you form this relative to ROM cohomology, you're throwing away some of the information because you can write down forms on X relative to the base field, but you're only using information about how to differentiate modulo the differentials of things on the base. So you're sort of throwing away the information about differentiating in the horizontal directions, and you're only using information about differentiating in the vertical direction. This suggests that maybe that information about the horizontal differentiation persists in this relative to ROM cohomology, and that is in fact what happens, and that is what is provided by the so-called Gauss-Monian connection of this data. So here's what the Gauss-Monian connection is from an operational point of view. I'll give you a formal definition, which will make your eyes glaze over on the next slide, but at least it will help convince you that I'm being honest. So let's say I have an affine. So let's say I'm in the situation that I ended the last slide with, where I have a smooth proper pair and the complement is affine over S, I guess. Let me also assume that S is affine so that I can really just compute things. Because, of course, I could compute this relative to ROM cohomology, I can compute locally on the base. So there's no harm at all in assuming the base is affine. So let's suppose that I have a U affine, which is a complement of a good pair, and I want to express the statement that the horizontal differentiation somehow persists in the relative cohomology. So what is an element of relative to ROM cohomology? Well, it's some class represented by a form in omega I, U over S, so the relative forms. And this form is, of course, a cocycle. When you differentiate it, you get zero. That's right, because HI is cocycles my coboundaries. So I'm going to choose a lift to omega U over K. So remember, I formed U over omega I U over S by killing off the pullbacks of differentials of things on S. So now I'm going to undo that. That's not a canonical operation. I've now made two choices. First, I chose the form representing this class, and now I chose a lift to the absolute module of differentials. So again, I'm going to have to, there's some independence of choices check that has to be made. But let me proceed anyway. So I can differentiate this form, and the answer is not necessarily zero, right? Because the form that I got in the relative module of differentials, that was a cocycle. That has derivative zero. But when you differentiate here, you might not get zero. I have an example which will maybe show you how this is working. Maybe after this, when I finish this slide, I'll show this to you an example. This is actually quite an easy recipe to carry out once you remind yourself how to do multivariable calculus, which I and my project apparently have trouble doing, because we all certainly I have trouble doing. But as long as as long as you can do multivariable calculus, you can do this. Those who can't teach, I suppose. So you differentiate this, you get something non-zero, but it projects to zero if you again passed relative differentials. What that lets you do is, if you have something which projects to zero in here, it turns out that you can you get a well-defined projection onto omega I. This is a typo. This should be omega I U over S. So your d omega ends up, you can project it onto omega I U over S tensor the pullback of omega 1 on the base, and then you send this thing into you actually get something which is in this guy, because you get the thing you get over here will be a cocycle, and you get something in here. So this is tensored over OU. This is tensored over OS. And so you've done that. You basically lift the form from being a relative form to being an absolute form, differentiate it, and then project back, and you end up with a map from your original relative cohomology to that tensor 1 forms on the base. And the magical things that happen are this doesn't depend on any choices. It turns out to be a connection, and it's even integrable. So all of these things happen, and you get something called the Gauss-Monning connection. Now, once upon a time, people thought about things more geometrically, working in the C-infinity category or the holomorphic category. And once upon a time, people didn't like thinking about connections, so they would just turn everything into a differential system and then convert the differential system into a differential equation, which amounts to, instead if you're being afraid of linear algebra and always working with characteristic polynomials. Of course, that's not an adequate substitute for linear algebra, but if you want to compute eigenvalues, say, of a matrix, you could conceivably start by computing the characteristic polynomial. Apparently, this is not what computers actually do, but it's what humans do. So people would flatten these connections into differential equations, and you would get things. You would get an example of what's called a Picard-Fuchs equation associated to your morphism. So these things have been studied a lot. Nowadays, physicists really like Picard-Fuchs equations. Classically, they're interpreted as telling you about the variation of periods, integrals of algebraic differentials on homology classes. Somehow, this has everything to do with things like mirror symmetry and other stuff that I don't understand. This has the fun consequence that, as Fernando can attest, physicists and number theorists actually have interesting things to talk about together. I think we even had our winter school about this a couple of years ago, which I didn't manage to attend, but some of that conversation happened here. So this is a point at which number theorists are approaching something that other people besides mathematicians even are interested in. Okay, so I owe you, let me show you how to make this honest, and then I'll go back and do an example, because this might look a little fishy. So here's how you make this honest, as I promised. This might make your eyes roll, glaze over. So in general, you might not actually be able to represent elements of Durham cohomology by individual forms if you're not working with an affine morphism. So of course you have these cocycles, which are, in this, you have this check complex, and you have cocycles in there. And the way the bookkeeping works here is there's a spectral sequence that does this. This was introduced by Katz and Oda. I guess it's based on Katz's PhD thesis. So what happens, and bear with me for just a moment or two while I do this. So you have your Durham complex, and the point is that you can filter this in an interesting way. Basically, you have this decreasing filtration. F0 is the whole complex. F1 is things generated by 1 forms on the base. So I've pulled up omega 1 on the base. If you can't write something in terms of a 1 form on the base, it's not in F1. F2 consists of things you can write in terms of 2 forms on the base, et cetera, et cetera. When you take this filtered complex, it gives you a spectral sequence. You do a funny thing here. Normally, when you do a spectral sequence, you care what happens when you get to the end. Here, I actually care about what happens at the step E1, and I don't actually care at all about what happens after that. So I'm getting the spectral sequence will degenerate to the cohomology of the total complex, which is to say the Durham cohomology of the total space. But I'm not actually interested in the Durham cohomology of the total space right now. I'm interested in the relative Durham cohomology, and that shows up at step E1. So step E1, you get forms on the base times relative Durham cohomology. And at E1, there's a differential D1 that goes from 0q to 1q. It goes from HQ to HQ tensor omega 1. That's the Gauss-Monning connection. That's a definition / theorem. The definition is this in algebraic Durham cohomology. The theorem is that if you do this with analytic, either real or real C infinity or complex analytic Durham cohomology, you actually get the classically defined Gauss-Monning connection, which I didn't describe, but it comes from locally trivializing your morphism, which you can do analytically, real or complex analytically, but not algebraically. So this actually gives you back the differential geometer's Gauss-Meinen connection. And it defines something in algebraic geometry, and it agrees with the recipe I gave on the previous slide, or rather explains the recipe on the previous slide. Because this is well-defined, and what I'm doing is computing it. So the thing I was computing is also well-defined. OK, example time. So I always use the same example. So all of these talks have the very same sort of example. It's always an elliptic curve. Now it's a family of elliptic curves. OK, so family of elliptic curves. How do you actually compute this? And the moral of the story is that this is really not so bad as long as you can do the algebra involved, which, I mean, at worst, you can put this on a computer and have the computer do it. But if you're careful, you can even do this by hand. So let's say I have the affine elliptic curve y squared equals px of t. So this is going to be over a subspace of the t line. And apparently I learned my, no, I didn't learn my lesson. I still have A's and B's. But this is, has an x in it. Yes, I was right on my notes. So x cubed plus ax plus b, except a and b are functions of a parameter t. This is over the subspace of the t line on which the discriminant is non-zero. The discriminant is, what is it? It's like 4a, what is it? 4a squared plus 27b cubed, something like that. 4a cubed plus 27b squared, that's right. That's better, because, yeah, that makes the degrees work out. I think I have it switched in my notes. So you have this family of elliptic curves, and so I'm going to get a relative h1, which is two-dimensional, and I want to commute the Gauss-Meinen connection. So first, I should write down a basis of the relative h1. So I'm going to do the same thing I did before. I'm going to choose a and b. These are polynomials in x with coefficients in the ring of functions on S, such that now I have to start writing partial derivatives. And the least cumbersome way to do this for this calculation, I think, is to use the subscript convention. So subscripting means take the partial derivative in that variable. Right, because the discriminant is non-zero, I can choose a and b polynomials in x over s, such that a times b plus b times px is 1. And now I'm going to make the omega that I made before. It's exactly the same formula I had before. And then I have a basis for h1 derom relative given by omega and x times omega. Okay.
How much can I reasonably fit on here?
So notice, in the relative module of differentials, I have the equation 2y dy equals px dx, just like before. But in the absolute module of differentials, this is no longer true, because I have to have a dt term as well. In the absolute module of differentials, this is the equation. Plus p, but I now I have to add pt dt. Okay. So okay, so now what do I have to do? I have to differentiate things So what do I do? So how do I compute the connection of some omega? Well, what I do is I write omega. So I have omega still sitting here. And I'm going to lift it. I, I'm I'm going to lift it by just taking the same sequence of symbols as an expression in the module of absolute differentials. And that's going to be my lift. So it's really, I differentiate lift given by the same expression. But now I have to view this in the module of absolute differentials. And so when I differentiate it, I start getting factors of t, of dt showing up. So when I differentiate this, I get, for instance, a dy wedge dx plus at y dt wedge dx plus 2, I'm losing this, plus 2 bx dx wedge dy plus 2 bt dt wedge dy. Right, I don't have to differentiate a with respect to x because that would give me a dx wedge dx, which doesn't do anything. And so now you start simplifying this. So I'm not going to write out all the details. You can see them in the notes. I just want to make the point that this is a completely reasonable calculation. So you use the fact that dy can be written in terms of dx and dt. So maybe the least complicated way to do this is to write everything in terms of something times a dt. So actually, I did this slightly differently in the notes. I wrote everything in terms of, what I did in the notes is I wrote everything in terms of omega wedge dt. So you can write everything in terms of, you straighten out all these terms, and every term you see will have a dt wedge something. And the something, this something, you could compute this modulo dt, right? This can be computed modulo dt because you're going to wedge it with dt. So that's the sense in which you can take this thing to be a relative differential. So whatever the term you get here, and you get, here's what you end up getting. I'll just show you the answer. Bx pt minus 1 half APT minus ATP minus BTPX. It's not so bad. So now what you have to do is you have to take this. This is some polynomial in X whose coefficients are functions of T. And now you apply the reduction process from lecture 1. So I'm going to take omega away. And now the point is that you can pretend t is a constant. If you want to think of it this way, you can pass to the generic point and apply reduction on the generic fiber of the morphism. So at this point, to do this reduction, you're doing the same thing that you did before. So the one step where you acknowledge the existence of the family is when you lift it and differentiate it. After that, you just pretend, again, like there is no family, and you just work with the individual, with sort of an individual curve, but say over the generic point. So the moral is that doing this computation is really not any harder than computing in the Durham cohomology of the individual fibers, or at least of the generic fiber of this morphism. So what this shows is that in general, if you can compute with the cohomology of a single member of a curve of some class, then you could compute the connection in a family. So this is, again, supposed to be not rocket science. It's basically calculus. Just the only complicated thing is you have to keep track of the step at which, you have to remember that at the key step you're lifting to the absolute space. And so you have to remember there's a parameter t. Let's see, how am I doing? Okay, so did I start at the top of the hour? Okay, so maybe I'll, I have a few things more to say, but maybe this is a good point to pause and ask for some questions, and solicit questions. So the one more thing I have to do is tell you how this applies to p-adic things, and I will do that shortly, but, yes? So in lecture 1, I told you how to compute the Durham cohomology of an elliptic curve by saying, well, okay, so I can write everything as a polynomial in x, well, it's a polynomial in x times y times this omega. And then I said, well, you can clear big powers of x by writing down relations, by differentiating things and producing relations that way. So you do the same thing here, except now your base field, if you like, contains t. So there at least one, possibly more than one example of this sort of thing is being computed by the project group. So you may see more of this when you see them. I'm going to skip that part of my notes because I'm going to do that next time. So here's the point. Hold on, let me quickly. Is that my last slide? No, it's just not doing anything. It's not clicking. There we are. That loosened. No. Yes. That will be difficult given that I don't have a cursor. Right? It hides. Acrobat Reader hides its cursor. Oh, there it is. Click on the slide. There we go. So where am I? I'm here. Okay. So this I'll come back to. I'll use that more next time. So here's the point. The point is that this Gauss-Meinian connection has a relationship to Frobenius actions, and analogous to the way that Durand cohomology of individual curves over ZQ, say QQ with good reduction, had to do with their special fiber. So let's say S is a smooth affine over ZQ. I'm going to take the completion along its special fiber and then analytify, and that gives me an affinoid space. It gives me the affinoid space corresponding to that, right? This is the Reynaud construction, right? Because I get a formal scheme like so. This is the Reynaud construction that we saw, I guess, at the end of Brian's third lecture. So you should be imagining that this is sitting inside the affine line. So this is, for example, this affinoid space might be, you know, the affine line minus some residue disks. So. And now I have to choose a lift of Frobenius on this thing. So I choose a map from A hat to itself, which mod P looks like the Q power Frobenius. And then I choose separately, I have a smooth proper morphism like so, which could also be a pair, but let me just say this for a smooth proper morphism. And that has that gives me a relative Durand cohomology on generic fibers. And in particular, I can restrict to this analytic space, right? Because that the sort of the points of that are sort of inside this generic fiber. So I have this vector bundle with the Gauss-Meinian connection. I can analytify it, and now here the amazing thing that happens, and this is really inspired by a whole bunch of examples of Dwork, but I think Bertolo is the first person to try to write this down in a systematic way, that there is actually a Frobenius action on the whole relative cohomology, which respects the Gauss-Meinian connection. So what does that mean? That means you have an isomorphism of vector bundles with connection, so that if you restrict to a point, you get the Frobenius action on Durand cohomology. But that only makes sense if this Frobenius lift maps the point to itself, right? Because typically the Frobenius, like say the Frobenius is like the power the Q power map. Say Frobenius sends t to t to the q, then you know, a typical value of t is not fixed by this map. There are a limited number of values which are. So if you look inside qq to the a, there are the so-called Teichmuller lifts, one per residue class, which are fixed under this map. And so you have to look, inspect at one of those fixed points. Because otherwise, this pulling back isomorphism is just relating two different fibers. But if you're relating the same fiber to itself, you get back the Frobenius action on here. On the next slide, I wrote this out more explicitly. So I will maybe finish by showing you how to write this explicitly and telling you what we want to use this for. So you can write Frobenius as a map, as a function on sections, which is sort of semi-linear with respect to the Frobenius you chose on functions. So it's not quite a linear map, but you can still represent it by a matrix by just writing the action of f on some basis vector in terms of the other basis vectors, if you're willing to keep track of the fact that when you conjugate, you skew it by hitting one side with Frobenius. But in any case, the data of Frobenius is in this matrix. So, I mean, if you have a basis of sections, you could reconstruct f from the matrix. And now, let's say I really am just looking at something in the affine line. I'm going to look at the action of d by dt, and that's represented by some other matrix. And then what happens is that this Frobenius isomorphism is an isomorphism of modules with connection. What does that mean in practice? What it means in practice is that if you write down these matrices for the Frobenius and the connection, they are interrelated by a sort of a differential equation. So you have N and its image under phi, and you have A and its image under differentiation, and they sort of intertwine in this way. This is just some function. And the point is that this N, which came from the connection, imposes a differential equation on the entries of the matrix A. So this gives you the following ability. If you can write down this connection, you have a differential equation on the matrix on the entries of the matrix A. You can solve the differential equation. Oh, wait, you need an initial condition. Right? To solve a differential equation, you need an initial condition. And the initial condition is the Frobenius action on one fiber. So if you have the Frobenius action on any one fiber, you can compute this, you can solve the differential equation and then compute the Frobenius action on some other fiber by evaluating without having to go through the cohomology calculation again. And this brings me to the final point, which is how you actually use this. This was suggested by Alan Lauder, and it's really a spectacular idea. You have some complicated variety, like, for instance, y squared equals p of x, where p of x is like x to the 2d minus 1 plus lots of terms plus some constant, some complicated hyperelliptic curve. What you do is you build this into a family where one of the other members of the family is a smooth curve, which is much, much simpler. So for instance, say q of x, so here's my other member of my family. This is just going to be x to the 2d minus 1, say, plus 1, which is a quotient of a Fermat curve. It has very symmetric. I mean, 2g, and now you build a family that interpolates between these two. Well, let's just take a pencil. So you just take t times 1 plus 1 minus t times the other. It's quite easy to make families. So you make that, and now you compute the connection. There will be some singularities, right? Because sometimes this does not give you a smooth curve. That will be the points that you have to throw out. And everywhere else, you get a connection. And you use that connection, and the Frobenius action at this one very simple fiber, which you can write down quite easily, to compute the Frobenius action at this somewhat more complicated fiber where it would be a little bit of a nuisance to write down the actual Frobenius lift on a weak completion and so on. So you avoid having to do anything hard as long as you can interpolate over to a situation where the job is easy or the job is already done. Maybe you did one and you just keep interpolating from it to other guys. So the part of the project is to play around with this construction, maybe with some simple examples. So I guess I should just stop there. What I'll do next time is tell you a little bit about the story of Frobenius actions on Durham cohomology of a variety of QP, which does not have good reduction. There's a similar story, but there are actually some things that are a little bit more mysterious. And in fact, I will tell you something to which I do not know the answer, although I have my suspicions. And where the part of the project is to do some experiments. There are a lot of parts to this project. Hopefully you'll hear about all of them. To do some experiments that suggest to inspect whether this proposal really makes sense. So I'll stop there. Could you say the question again? I didn't quite follow. So you have a scheme in characteristic P, you mean, and you have the, you're looking at like the Durham cohomology of a smooth proper morphism?
Yeah.